welcome to Talks at GS, and I'm really delighted to be joined by my friend Virginie Morgon. And in March, Virginie will assume the role of CEO of Eurasio, a leading European-based private equity firm. She's currently deputy CEO of the firm worldwide and president and CEO of Eurasio North America. So Virginie, welcome.
Thank you.
So I thought first, for those who don't know much about the firm, why don't you describe its vision in terms of its culture and investments?
We are French by culture, by history. We grew European for sure. I'm very European by conviction, by background. I studied in Paris, also in Milan. I did my master at the Bocconi University. I deeply feel European, so I started to expand Eurasio from 2010 outside France, making direct investment in European companies, in Italy, in the UK, in Spain, for just to name a few, including Switzerland, which doesn't sort of, is part of Europe, but is certainly a European country. So we grew European, and my ambition is to become way more global. Not just, you know, because this is fun, but because I believe this is what we need to bring to the company in which we invest. There's no way out of being just global, and hence the decision to come to the US and establish the franchise.
How has the firm changed and grown since you've been there? You talked about the number of people you have, but what are the biggest changes?
This is my motto. I mean, I've got a few mottos like we all have. Get out of your comfort zone when you're strong enough. And that's something we did really every year over the last 5 years. And, you know, the latest expansion in the US is very much getting out of our comfort zone. And the other motto is don't just do something because we've done that for so many years. You know, let's start from a blank piece of paper and see how we can reshuffle, you know, the way we assess an investment, the way we process a due diligence, so start from scratch every time.
So let's pivot a little, talk about the macroeconomic landscape. So it's now early January 2018, and 2017 was a really volatile year politically, both in the US and in Europe, but economically things continue to look up. So what's your general outlook for the global economy this year and beyond?
Okay, I'm positive. I'm probably less positive than a lot of what we read in the press these days, but I'm certainly very positive. I'm positive on Europe. We've never had in Europe UK aside, mm-hmm. But continental Europe, which has gone through very tough times since 2009, and France in particular, seems to, you know, be on the road of growth again. I think the perspective for next year is probably north of, 1.5-2% growth. But, you know, beyond just the number, I think the confidence that you find in terms of spirits in France has immensely changed since, of course, the presidential election. And you will see more... more growth in the future in a number of those countries. Germany was already pretty strong, but Italy, Spain, and France will show growth that we've never had for many, many years. So Europe plus China plus a positive outlook in the US for the next 18 months, I think short term it should all be good. The question is more long term as usual, and where do you see the crisis coming from? A lot of business leaders seems to mention the end of 2019 as sort of a risk period, and I'm thinking, is it because there's a positive outlook for sure for the next 18 months, and then there's not much else to say than the risk is likely to be by 2019, or is it because they see something like happening or cooking already, which I don't see in the portfolio companies that we had, at least not for the moment. So I'm pretty positive.
That's good. I hope you're right. Can you talk a little bit about your views on the debate between nationalism and globalism that's happening around the globe, in Asia, Europe, and here?
Yeah, I mean, it's been a debate for years. We did not mention that, but I think it's important that I'm also, you know that, Ali, but the audience do not. I'm very involved with Human Rights Watch. I'm co-chairing the Paris Committee of Human Rights Watch. I was actually yesterday at a meeting of Human Rights Watch in New York. And you see a number of those trends of nationalism in Asia, in Europe. And this shows that we've been unable so far, we as business leaders, we as CEOs of companies, to explain that there's no way out of globalization and that the consequences of globalization are not as negative as some people think. But there's an enormous challenge of being able to explain in a very convincing way that the left aside or the left behind, which is a reality, are not just left aside or behind because of globalization.
Before we talk a little bit about women in leadership, because I want to spend a few minutes on that, you've obviously seen enormous success throughout your career. And I just would love you to share with us, you know, how do you define success? When people, you know, you talk about a successful career, how do you define that?
I don't know, you tell me. Maybe being invited at the Goldman Sachs talk show.
That is success. Touché. Talks at GS.
Time goes by, and then you sort of, you know, progressively realize that you're climbing some form of ladders, you're being promoted. So that's the start, as sort of, you know, the career path. But that sounds like, you know, very 1980s. And then when I think success is where you finally realize that you have in your hands the power to make things move. Can be in your own organization, where you suddenly realize that when you say you want something done, it happens, and like then you realize you're probably the boss. And then make it happen also when you give more of your time. It's a question of age. It's a question of probably realizing that you can impact outside your professional life. I think that's success as well. I mean, I tend to say, and I realize by saying it, that I'm a very lucky person, that the most valuable thing in my life, you know, beyond my friends, my kids, is my time. Because I have the luxury of, you know, not having to think about, you know, the end of the month, living very comfortably. But what's more valuable is my time. And when I decide to allocate part of my time to a number of, you know, being very impactful with women's, with other different causes, then you think this is part of the success, because you're being able, because you're perceived as a business leader, as being able to impact the way things goes. That's probably, you know, the KPI of a form of success.
But I will say that we appreciate you committing your time to us today. So let's talk about your role as a female leader in finance. And we'd just love to get your perspectives about women leaders in our industry. And you talked a little bit about your responsibilities in that. But as one of the few female CEOs, which you will be starting in a month or so, what do you feel about your responsibilities to the industry?
I mean, there's tons of things I'd like to say about that. So I think this is very sad that we still have to fight, you know, to protect and give a chance to women in 2018. I believe that we should be empowering women by just telling them, you know, let's not make a big, you know, a big issue about being a woman. Be professional, be extremely committed, which we usually are. Network is very important. I've realized pretty late, like 30, I was 32, 33, that was a piece of advice I was given, that we should be networking way more. We women, but, you know, more generally. And I think this is very right. Spend some time networking and exposing yourself in a way, exposing yourself, being connected, in order to give, to create option, to create opportunities, to create, to give yourself visibility, which we don't do for, but for the wrong reason. I think we don't do at that period of the time because we're very busy, because we're probably constructing our families, we're having, you know, kids, we're being pregnant, we're busy, and we think, you know, we have other things to do, and, you know, networking is not really a priority. Mm-hmm. I think that's a mistake. I think networking is very key. And my conviction, absolute conviction, is that an organization is way more performing and efficient with women on board and with more diversity. It's true for culture, for nationality, for gender. It's true across the board. So I am, you know, it goes well beyond, you know, ethics, or we are absolutely better from an organization perspective, from an efficiency perspective, with women around the table.
So here in the U.S., we've seen a wave of women come forward with stories of sexual harassment across industries, which has not only led to the ousting of many powerful men, but also to a reexamination of the workplace culture. And what is your global view of this at the moment, given that you really do think more broadly than just about the U.S.?
I think this ability for women to express their concern without being, you know, afraid of, you know, very basically losing a job or losing a promotion, or, you know, option, or just being, you know, ashamed of talking about it, I think that's an enormous step forward, enormous step forward.
So we talk a lot about the importance of culture here at Goldman. When it comes to gender equality, how do you approach building a corporate culture? You talked a lot about why diversity is important for a successful business, but how do you approach actually building that?
I mean, building a culture is the most difficult thing of all, and it's going to take 20 years. But it starts every day. I mean, it's on the two extremes. It's the vision and the strategy, where you clearly indicate in the company that we want gender equality on all fronts. You know, of course, equality of pay, but, you know, we want a large number of women in the organization. We want to promote women, and women have a say, you know, in the investment decision. So at very senior level, opening the executive committee to women, promoting women on the boards. So that's the decision making, that's the statement that we make. And on the other extreme, it's every day. In every day of the life, you have to demonstrate that this is what you want to do. So you know, every hire, I want to see a woman as well as a man. And I don't let it go if I'm only seeing men. And I just cancel the meetings in my agenda if I don't have another woman which is busy, you know, being sort of interviewed for the job, or any comment which I think are, you know, not proper, I would immediately voice over, you know, during meetings, during board meetings. I think you can't let it happen, you know, with those comments at the coffee machine, or at, you know, that starts by fighting on the ground, and also having the strategic vision, and then across the board, I guess after many years of efforts, the organization will be convinced at all level, including every man, that this is a positive.
Best advice you've ever received?
I mean, it's not an advice that I received, but it's an experience I had. I was 24, 25. I was in one of the partners, Lazard Partners' office, standing, you know, not standing, sitting in front of his desk, and he was taking tons of calls, and I think I had been waiting for about an hour and 45 minutes. Doing nothing, because that was a number of years ago. We had no BlackBerry, no iPhone at the time. And I saw someone coming in his office who was slightly more senior than him, but we're talking very senior people there. And there was this interaction between the two in a form of sort of humiliation of one sort of, you know, vis-a-vis the other. And I thought, I was only 24, and I thought inside, you know, I had been waiting an hour and 45 minutes for nothing, because that person was way too busy and taking tons of calls. And every time I was like standing to go back to my desk, he would do. But then this person comes in, way more senior than him, and there's this interaction, and I thought, I am never going to allow anyone to speak to me the way he's been addressed by this other very senior partner of the firm, because that's humiliating. You know, we're human being, I respect myself, there's no way on earth I'll be going through that. And that's how I behaved for years. I mean, there's no way you can be treated the way some of those firms in the past, but still now in some situation, would treat, you know, people. Respect, decency, ethics, and, you know, respect yourself first, and then you'll be respected. I think that's an enormous piece of advice.
That's great advice. Thank you. Well, we're about out of time, so I wanted to thank you so much,
Virginie.
And please join me in thanking Virginie.
Thank you.